Hi everyone, thank you so much for coming along. It's so lovely to meet you. It's really lovely to see you all. I'm Siân, I write for theatre and radio, and so tonight I'm going to be talking about finding inspiration. As Adam has said, it's going to be really informal. I'm going to give you some exercises to do. It's going to be quite exercise heavy. So have you all got pens and pads or laptop? Anything you need to write? If you need me to go over anything, please just say. If you need longer to process things, if you need me to repeat, if you can't hear, please tell me no, because that's all on me and I'll be happy to do any of that. Likewise, if you want any of the, I'm going to give you some kind of things to jump into for your inspiration. So if you want any of the stuff I share, we can provide that for you after. I'll sort that out with Adam. So if at any point you don't want to join in now, you want to do it later, or if a small child or cat or dog comes in, just totally informal. I'm actually in a little haven in a hotel room tonight. Otherwise, my two children would be joining us, I'm sure. So please don't worry about any of that. It's all totally fine. So I'm going to start by just having a bit of a think about finding inspiration. And I think at the moment, there's a lot of pressure on us as writers to come up with stuff. It's been a heavy time. I think, I don't know about you, but as a writer, I kind of feel like there's a lot to say, but I don't know if I'm the right person to say it. And so I kind of just want you to throw all that away tonight. Don't even think about it. Don't think about the big stuff. Don't think about what you should think you should be writing, or what you feel like theatres want or radio producers want. This is about finding inspiration in you and around the things that you experience every day. So I just want you to take all pressure off. And this is about really mini exercises that I do when I'm needing inspiration, or also things that I do in the middle of a project, if I'm stuck on a character, or if I'm not sure what's going to happen next, or if I'm just sat there just unsure with a blank page. These are all the things that have come from my experience, and also from other brilliant people that I've been mentored or taught by. So some of it is recycled, and I fully don't take credit for all of it. Some of it is from other brilliant people too, but I hope it inspires. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to share, I've made a PowerPoint in a very 90s, 86 fashion. So I think you could still see me, but I'm going to go through the PowerPoint. But just feel free to jump in. Oh, thank goodness. I'm quite terrified of them, PowerPoints, because I never know how to start. Right. Am I sharing that? Hey, okay. So I'm just going to check if the slide, you know, when you press the arrow, I'm just going to check. Yeah. Okay. So the first thing I want you to do, and I'm going to set a little timer for you. I'm going to set timers for you the whole time. Obviously, we've only got just over an hour tonight, I think. But these exercises can be done for much longer if you want to, in your own time. I'm going to take it down to 3 or 4 minutes for each one, but you can do it for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, whatever you want to do. Or you can spend a whole day on these things if you want to. But just for now, I'm just going to give you the kind of the structure to start them. And the first thing I want you to do is to write for 3 minutes on absolutely anything. And I know this is horrible. I hate this one. When mentors or workshop leaders say this to me, I'm like, oh God, go away. But you can literally write anything. And I just want you to get into that emotion with your hands and your brain and the connection. You can just write, I am writing, I am writing, I am writing, if you want to. You can write about what you had for tea, what you're looking at. Just write anything. And I'd like you to do that for 2 minutes. We'll just take it down to 2 minutes, just really short. We won't be sharing anything, so please don't worry about that. But I just want you to get into that kind of groove, okay? So I'm going to start you now and I'll stop you in 2 minutes. So now I just want you to have a look through what you've written and just find one word or one line that sings to you out of everything. It can just be like a fun word or something that surprises you, and just underline that. And that's it. But the brilliant thing about free writing and that is that, say for example, you were having a day where the writing isn't just flowing or you just don't even know where to start. You start with that, get your head and your hands and your fingers working if you're typing. But then the thing that you've just underlined might be the best thing to start the next bit of free writing with. So only write for the next 3 minutes based on the bit that you underlined. And keep going and keep going. And sometimes that can just be enough to kind of tangle something, or just to start flowing, or to suddenly think, oh, I really want to be writing about boats, or I need to concentrate on that the character loves yellow. So it can just be a really, really handy way of just unlocking the stuff that might be way back behind shopping lists and Sue Gray reports and all that kind of stuff. So it's just a really, really lovely thing, I think, to do. And also take the pressure off, because you can literally write, this is rubbish, I hate it, for 3 minutes. And you can get that out as well. You can get your writer rage out. So that's a really lovely exercise that the wonderful Sarah Dickinson taught me a long time ago. So I'm going to move on. So artists, writers, find inspiration in all ways, but these are the things that inspire me and where I always go to when I'm starting a new project or when I'm thinking about something. I'm quite a visual learner and quite a visual person. So when I'm working on a project, I gather things. And the first thing I often get inspired by is photographs, and in particular, documentary photographs. So I use photos to either completely start something new, which is what I'm going to show you in a minute, or if I know a topic I'm going to be researching, or I know that I want to write about, I go and dive into photographs about that and just have them all around. And it's never wasted, because you can hang on to them, you can reuse them, and later on down the line in a project. So for example, with Adam and Voxer Chicks and the indie musical, I just have loads of photos that I love from 1997, and I kind of hold it up to Adam and say, I want the character to be this. Like, I don't know what be this means, but he kind of knows what I mean. So it can be a really helpful way to have conversations as well between yourselves, directors, sound engineers, even lighting, costume. So I always love photographs for so many ways. So I'm going to throw you in at the deep end. I've got three photographs from places and photographers that I love. One's just a random one off the internet. And I want you to, okay, I'm going to show you the first one. So this is an amazing website, and can you see the link, Amber Online? Is that cool? I'm glad that came up. So again, we can send you the links and everything like that. This is an amazing documentary photograph site that I've been using for years. And it's a very beautiful mix of everyday people in extraordinary circumstances. So they have photos about when the mines closed in certain places, or like 1986, or when housing estates are being bulldozed. So that's very much kind of my bag. I really like kind of bleak stuff, but this photograph has always absolutely just stopped me in my tracks. And so I'd just like you to use this and write for 3 minutes. And what I'd like you to do is write a scene. And it doesn't matter if you've never written a scene before, It doesn't have to be a good scene. You don't even have to like have character names. You can be A, B, or C. You don't have to use all the characters. Just use that picture to inspire you to write a scene. What is happening in that picture? 3 minutes, go. That's it. So I just want to ask you all how you found that. If there was anything, how was that? Was that all right for everyone? So if anyone's got anything particular to question or, so one of the things that I love about photographs for writing is that often when you start off with a scene, I don't know if it's the same for everyone else, but for me it can just be characters and that can sometimes make it a bit stuck. But the thing that I love about looking at photographs is that it can give a scene texture. So you have to think about the weather. Like this looks like a really hot day, but the little kid's got like a jacket on. That's really intriguing to me. The guy looks to be absolutely soaking wet. I think the lady is too. Like it looks like maybe they were caught in the rain or there was a bucket of water thrown over them. I don't know. Dartboard up. Like there's just loads of things to think about. So when you're writing those scenes that maybe you're a bit stuck on, if you find a photograph that kind of sings to you in the way that your scene does, you can really begin to add in things, if that makes sense. Does that make sense? So you can really kind of add to the picture.
Yeah, I think the visual approach, you know, inspiration is really interesting. It's like I definitely, when I read a script, I visualize it. And I've kind of talked to Hannah about this because she doesn't so much. She kind of just reads it as a story on a page. And I think kind of, you know, obviously this is kind of reverse engineering, isn't it? This is kind of going to the image and then like finding inspiration from that. But it's just interesting, isn't it? Like how brains work and like actually what starting point for a story is and how that story is conjured, you know, in your head.
Absolutely. And I think the other thing as well is that sometimes when, especially I think writing for stage, you can feel like it has to be quite constrained. So like it's often, you know, when you start off in a studio setting, it's a black box, you know, you kind of want to throw everything at it. But you're restrained by budgets or things like that. But actually what I kind of want to get to you all is that you don't have to think about that at the beginning. Like that all comes later and that's for the director to worry about. Like you can absolutely put into your scripts, you know, I think I put in my stage direction once there's an earthquake and the floor opens up. So like, you know, you can really use the visuals of photography to kind of give that whole world picture that I think sometimes you can be scared to go down, especially in theatre and you know, radio as well. Like you can go anywhere, but sometimes that's too big because, you know, they say like, oh, you know, you can be in space or, well, I've never been to space, I don't know what to do. But if I found a photograph of it, you can really capture maybe the isolation or the coldness sometimes, you know, those amazing photographs of like, you know, frozen hands and I don't know, it's just such a beautiful way, I think, of breaking down the barriers of being afraid to create your world and being specific and putting tiny details into a script can really change it. Like a scene between two people having an argument will be very different in the middle of a heat wave to one in the middle of a snowstorm. So although that sounds crazy, like photographs can really help you find that specificity and the world around the characters as well, which will inform them and push them on. So this is why my next photo, this is a photo of it was taken in the 80s and or early 90s. And it's from where I'm from in Newport, which is why I love it. And the photographer is David Barnes. And I just want you to write for 2 minutes, I want you to write a monologue for this guy. And just thinking about what I was saying, like, what's he carrying? What's the weather? Where's he been? what's he looking at? Like, is that a playground behind him? Just have a real look at the photograph and try and think about seeing the character in this world, in this weather, in those shoes, and write for 2 minutes, please. So the last one on photographs is not people, but things. Like, this is something that always really bothers me when I'm out and about. Like, I live in Brighton and there's always shoes and wires. And because I'm a writer, like, I can't help but just sit then and just work out why there's a shoe and a wire. And like, there's loads of urban myths. Like, I had to look it up when I was looking at this photograph. Which is another brilliant wormhole you can go down. Urban myths, that's another inspiration. But apparently there are loads of urban myths around shoes and wires. There's like where there's like drug dens, apparently, or someone's been lost nearby, or where just the thing that broke my heart was when people move away from a place, they just want to leave something of theirs there and tell the place that they were there once, which speaks to all my writing sensibilities. So there are so many mad things, or it could just be that someone's been an arse and thrown another kid's shoes over wires, which is probably what would have happened to me when I was a kid. So if you would like, let's just do 2 more minutes on this, but just take any inspiration from this photograph. I don't want to be too prescriptive. The other ones were kind of easier in a way because they've got people in them. But now I'm asking you to find a story about some shoes, but I know you can do it. So have 2 minutes. Stop there, please. Well done, team. Sorry, I'm working you hard tonight, but I'm hoping it's getting all the creative juices flowing. So I always go for documentary photos, but that's just me. Like, if you are inspired by photographs, just use your own if you want to. Or use a favourite scene, use whatever you want. I think they're such a helpful way of getting into a world and beginning thinking about people, place, and the overall kind of specifics. So I think for me, they're probably one of the first things I'll ever use on a project. So I'm hoping that was helpful for you all. The next thing is real people, but that's kind of like, I didn't really know how to explain this, so bear with me. So up until very recently, I was also a librarian, and I worked in a university library that had incredible archives and something called the Keep, which had which houses something called the Mass Observation Archive, which is basically where the Mass Observation trustees ask people to write in on certain directives. So they'll say things like, write about the royal wedding, like in 1981, or write about the weather or the cost of fuel. And everyone writes in about what they think about it, and then they store them. And it goes back to like the 1980s, 70s, 60s, 50s. There's also an incredible war collection in the archives. And when I was really stuck on something, I was writing a play that had to be set in lots and lots of eras. And I was so stuck, I couldn't kind of get into different time zones. So I used my librarian head and my free library ticket and went and started looking at archives. And I've never looked back. And it's just such a wonderful way in. And I just want to share it with you, the ways that you can kind of access the words and thoughts and records of real people to inspire. Like, obviously you have to be careful in terms of, you know, using their actual words. Like, if you're writing about somebody specific, you have to, you know, go through the right channels. If you're quoting something, but I didn't use it like that. I just kind of used it to kind of dive into certain time zones. And I think this is particularly useful inspiration if you want to write something in a different era or a different time or a different sensibility. I think this can be a really amazing place to go and dig. So I've given you some very similar. I've taken pictures and I'm gonna give you some kind of jump off points to go and to write with. But there are so many resources out there. I've only listed a few in the end of this. But if that's something you want to know more about, feel free to contact Adam to find out more, because it's something that I've deeply into and deeply geeky about, and know of quite a few cool places if you were into something specific with my old librarian head on. So if I can help in any way, let me know. But this is just to kind of give you a taster. So this is, I mean, diaries are just extraordinary. And the problem with most diaries is that it's got like real thoughts in, right? So you can't necessarily maybe use them in a play because they're actual thoughts, unless you, you know, you quote them and say you've quoted them exactly. But this is brilliant because this is like a slice of 1982 and it doesn't say anything, but everything is brilliant about it. I immediately wanted to write a play about this and I might steal it. I don't know what it is, but like, who's Susan Perkins? I mean, we all know about Lady Diana, but like, what? Like, what was she coming to the town? Like, this is David Byrne again, so it was like in Wales, so maybe she was coming to visit, I don't know. Does that say B11 or 311? I don't know. And then what are those numbers? I don't know. It's just brilliant. There's so much brilliance in these two pieces of text. And the thing that I love about it is this is someone's life. Like, this is just a tiny snapshot. Like, you can tell I'm getting geekily excited. This is me when like I'm well into it. This is what Adam has to put up with when I have an idea. But it's so brilliant and such a lovely way in, because I just want you guys just to go and write for 3 minutes, because this is so brilliant. Like, you can either be Lady Diana, I don't know. You could be on the 311 bus, going to buy something. You can be Susan Perkins, or maybe you're meeting Susan Perkins. But please use this as an inspiration to write a scene or a monologue or a slice of something for the next 3 minutes. Okay, so stop there. I'm still completely fascinated. Like, I love how Susan Perkins is given the same weight as Lady Diana. Like, they're both in capitals, equally as important. I love that. So moving on, because otherwise I'll just geek out on that all day. This is actually from the Mass Observation collection. These are curated by wonderful friends of mine as well, who very carefully look after everything. And you can, the brilliant thing about some of these resources is you don't even have to go there. You can look them up online. The links are here beneath, and you can really dive in. Like, if you're going to do something on the 80s or 90s, it's a really brilliant place. They've got very particular kind of topics as well, so you can really, you know, if you're looking for specific topics, just have a look. It's absolutely brilliant. And I'm just going to read this one out in case the thing is bad for everyone. So this is, someone was writing about pastimes, and they were, the directive was write about your pastimes. And so you just had to write about what you do. And this was in 1989. And someone put, TV, watch the news at midday. Used to watch a soap, but no time now. Don't video it. Love, like, video is amazing. Put on morning TV if anything special happening, storms, etc. Always watch weather forecast, a complete waste of 5 minutes usually. From 5:15 p.m. watch blockbusters, then news, current affairs. Wash up for half hour, then 7:30 Coronation Street or Emmerdale Farm. no money-winning shows. We like nature films, good movies, detective stories, like nicely spoken personalities, hate strident voices. I mean, there's already a character there, right? That's just a brilliant way to start anything. During the day, I read a newspaper, a magazine, part of a book. I like a new funny book or glossy mag when traveling. I used to read when eating, but now listen to my TV. My back faces the set. Brilliant. I do not belong to library anymore. Used to have 4 tickets and changed books weekly. I do listen to reviews and sometimes I'm guided by them, not often. My granddaughter has a Saturday job in our library and it is very nice there. And the brilliant thing about reading actual real people is that they're completely mad and quirky and full of contradictions. Like, she doesn't belong to the library anymore, but it's a really nice place. Like, why? What did she do? Why doesn't she belong to the library anymore? And why does she sit with her back facing the TV? Like, does she do that to watch all her programs? Like, this is the things that you can just start to brilliantly create characters. And again, obviously with the utmost respect to the people who have written this, but it is a brilliant way in. And all those kind of quirky things. So again, like, I'm conscious of time, so I won't get you to write anything on this, but if you want to have a look through the mass observation, it is a brilliant place. There's some incredible, in fact, the whole University of Sussex, the Keep, have, I'm just bigging it up because I used to work there, but it's got an incredible archive of directives from wartime as well. And I was writing part of one of my plays was about it would set in the different eras. One was set in the 1940s, and it's just extraordinary to read about an everyday experience with this kind of mad thing, you know, like rationing and planes flying over, and yet someone's still kind of really upset about something not being delivered. Or it was just an incredible way of really cutting through some of the other stuff. And I think if you're going to write about something that's been written about quite a lot as well, this is a brilliant way in. Archives are a brilliant way in to go and find real gold. And the other amazing thing is that lots of university libraries have very specific collections. Sussex has got LGBTQ collection, the LSE have got the women's library, and so they're kind of carefully curating and collecting very specific bits of history, and you can find posters and tickets and bits of paraphernalia. I was looking through just before I left, and there was, our library had collected like all the pamphlets from like the 1986 general election. And it's just mad. It's just the same thing over and over again. It might as well have been yesterday. So it's just brilliant. And I just wanted to highlight this kind of thing that you can get. Again, we won't do anything with this for time, but it's a really powerful thing. If you wanted to write really specifically about a certain issue or a certain time or place, you know, what was going on in the world, like, could you set a scene in a rally? Who was there? What are the noises? What's going on? What would they have seen? It can just be a brilliant, it's time travel, basically, is what it is. And it's an absolutely brilliant way of getting right in there. So if you want any more information, there'll be links at the end, but it's incredibly useful and inspiring thing. Also, if you've got absolutely no idea about anything, but you want to pretend that you're doing work for writing, archives are a brilliant way of sitting down on your computer and looking at stuff.
Suzanne was asking if anyone can access archives.
Yeah, I think things like the LSE Women's Collection, the Women's Library, the Keep, the Mass Observation, not every single thing is on there, but they put like really brilliant things out there. And they also, you can also go and visit them, and I know things are tricky with COVID, but things are opening back up again, but there's always details on there. Often what they do is they kind of have a kind of welcome page, and it'll tell you everything about visiting, what's available online. But during COVID, a lot of libraries were purposely putting archive material online so that researchers, and I know our university was, so researchers could access while they were wherever. So it's becoming much more of a bigger thing. There's more links at the end, but there's also like the National Archives, there's the British Film BFI. I've got links on there. There's loads of different places you can go. But yeah, a lot is available online. So I know this is probably a bit grim and no one wants to talk about the news, but you can also find some brilliant inspiration from the newspapers. And this is a bit like the free thinking at the beginning as well. Like, I'm not one to look at newspapers at the moment. I'm doing my best to avoid them. But I think it can be really useful to go to local newspapers and find brilliant headlines like this. So appeal to return coat to man. That's like, why? What did he do? Like, what colour are the wrong socks? Well, I just don't know. But why are they wrong and why are they socks? Drunk for invisible man, which has to be one of my favourite things ever. And if the news didn't want to write itself, now we've got ambushed by a cake. I mean, you know, you can go big or small. But so just for a bit of fun. Oh yeah, and there's another serious one up there about second car fire in a matter of weeks. So you can go really dark, but I think sometimes it's really good just to kind of go light and find the local ones. Another brilliant thing to do is to get a newspaper, cut out all the words in the headlines, and then make new headlines, and then write a story based on your headline. That's lovely in so many ways, because when you get to cut faces of politicians up, but also you get to maybe use that creative side of your brain. Like, I don't know about you, but I love sticking and pasting. And so you can actually like move stories around, and that can be really helpful too, just to get in. And that's another like real no pressure, just write for a little bit without any big thoughts. Because sometimes big thoughts can get in the way. So if you don't mind, I'd like you to pick one of those and write for 2 minutes. And I really hope it's Drunk for Invisible Man, because that sounds amazing. Okay, that's it. Thank you. And thanks for all the comments in the chat. Sorry, I've just caught up with that. This newfangled technology. I'm really glad the photos helped you get in, and paintings, yes. Pictures of inside buildings. Yeah, I love a picture of an inside building. The census is brilliant. I started going down that wormhole the other day and had to come off quickly. But yeah, that's another brilliant thing. Thank you for that. Okay, so how are you doing? I've worked you hard for almost an hour, but we've just got one more inspirational thing to talk about, and then we can just chat and you can ask any questions or tell me to go away, whichever one you prefer. So the last thing is music. So as Adam said, I'm writing a musical with him, which has been a joy, because I just get to be 16 and listen to all my favourite songs and wear band t-shirts and pretend I'm back there. But I've always used music as an inspiration. I don't know about you guys, but if I've got a project, I usually have like one, it's got like a theme tune. Like, I have one song that kind of I listen to over and over again when I'm writing, or like maybe a few pop up. But this is another really lovely way of sparking your brain if things are heavy, and I know that things are really heavy at the moment. And I think during lockdown, I kind of really struggled with finding creativity when, you know, everything was going on. So this is another really light way, and something you can do. You know, you can go out for a walk, put your headphones in, what's really interesting to do is just shuffle your library, or like shuffle a library on iTunes that you've never heard. Like I put New Wave on the other day and I was like, oh, okay. And like Duran Duran and things like that were coming through. And I was like, okay, this is awesome. So we're going to do two exercises in the next bit. And I hope the technology works. Here we go. So there's two ways that I use music and wanted to share with you. One is by like the lyrics and the mood of a song and actually like thinking about a story around the lyrics. It's already been done for you. They're kind of often stories in songs themselves. And then also there's music videos, which I always love how someone takes a mad idea and puts it on top of the soundtrack. Like there's already been a process going on, but what I really love is they're like kind of really short, tiny films, but you then can bounce off them too. So we're going to just, I'm not going to play you all the songs, both of the songs, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to, hopefully you know the Beatles one, but don't worry if you don't, it comes up with the lyrics and it's an incredibly sad song. And I remember hearing it like when I was 13, 14 and crying for about 6 weeks and just like, this is terrible. Like she's left home and her mum and dad find that she's left home and where's she gone and how did my mum and dad feel? And that's what I mean about songs jumping off. And this was the one that I was really thinking about. But you might have, you know, a piece of opera or just classical music and that's telling you a story and you're thinking about people all of a sudden. So I want you to first listen to the Beatles, She's Leaving Home. And while it's on, just write for 2 minutes and I'll stop it after 2 minutes. But think about the story that's being told and try and get inspiration from it. So maybe you're writing about the girl, like maybe you're her, she's left home, or maybe you're the mum, or maybe you're the next door neighbor who's seeing everything. I hope that makes sense and I hope this works. No, brilliant. Hang on. Okay, I've got an idea. That's for me a really powerful way in, and also if you're writing something and you're trying to get into a feeling, like, you know, if I was writing another story and I just couldn't quite get there with the characters, like you can put on a song that takes you there and it can be really helpful just to open those doors. You know, that one's about loss and betrayal and heartache. You know, you can really kind of find those gears through music. So I think it's a really good way of switching the pressure. Take the pressure off yourself and let someone else who's already done it beautifully just guide you in. And so the last thing is I'm going to show you a very silly video, but it makes me laugh a lot. And I love music videos for very many reasons, but Christopher Walken dancing is one of the very best things ever. And I think the thing that I love about music videos is they can be quite extreme and quite brave and quite bold in their direction, and you know, like they can be explosive, and you know that thing we were talking about, worlds and being scared maybe to go there with your writing when you kind of sat on your own, and they can be brilliant to watch to kind of go, oh yeah, but also they've often got very tiny stories in them that you can jump off. So for this one, write while you watch, but think about like maybe questions like, who's the guy, like why is he waiting, why is he dancing, and why can he fly? I'll give you 2 minutes. Right, can you see it now?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. And I'm going to stop it there, even though the flying man is awesome. But hopefully, if nothing else from this ramble of mine, if ever you're feeling low when you're writing, just put that on. So I hope that's helped. And I hope I'm going to stop sharing my screen. Maybe we can just have a chat. And any questions? How are you all? I'm sorry I worked you hard there.
Yeah, it's amazing. I was actually thinking about it from like the other side, as a director, and like, you know, having worked together, like actually sharing some of those inspirations is really interesting and a way in and a way of enriching that experience of, you know, shared communication and how you kind of found shared language and, you know, way into that world and everything else. Yeah, it's fascinating, isn't it?
It is, and it can be so useful to share that with collaborators, or, you know, later on down the line with lighting and all kinds of stuff. But I think just to have a bank of stuff you can turn into when you're really feeling loaded or dry or heavy, because I think it can really take over, and like an act of writing can be very heavy. And I think sometimes we forget it can be fun too. And like, actually, let's just change gears. And I've really found, especially when I'm under pressure, you know, I used to kind of sit there for hours, like looking at the screen going, I'm writing. And I wasn't, I was just like writing a word. And so I think just sometimes just shifting your mind space into music or photographs, it can just do such a slight shift change, but it open up so much. So I hope that was useful for you all, and just like a little bit of joy in an otherwise mad world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's great. I find it interesting as well, like that the imaginative space as well, how we kind of project stories, like you're saying about music videos, our instinct watching those is to kind of create a story around it, a narrative. Yeah. You know, instinctively. And like you're saying about, you know, like those photos, particularly that first photo and the conflict that was in there, and how that's kind of a way in. It's just you know, it reminds me like that relationship between an audience and a piece of work on stage. Do you know what I mean? And that imaginative space that we kind of fill collectively. Do you know what I mean? It's, yeah, very interesting.
It's kind of like the things that I used to use creatively when I was a kid as well, you know, so like music or pictures, when the pressure was off not to be writing, you know, and you could just tell stories, whatever, like it's really lovely to think about those things that are just inherently in you. And I think sometimes finding the thing that inspires you, for me, so like photos or music, just helps me remember my voice as well, and just remember who I am and what I'm trying to do. I think there's so much pressure on us all at the moment to write the next big thing, you know, or like to speak to the universe as it is now, or to kind of come up with the answers. And there's a heavy pressure on us all. And I think actually, if we can kind of turn away from that a little bit and just go back into us and go back to the things that have always kind of inspired us, then those stories will come, and they'll be even better for it, because they'll be coming from true places. And, you know, we won't be writing the COVID play, or do you know what I mean? It's like that thing of trying to go right back in, I think, and not to feel afraid about that, just be absolutely proud of the things that, you know, I hate kind of highbrow stuff with writing, you know, like you had to have done a certain thing, or you had to have gone on a certain course, or, you know, it's rubbish. You find your own ways in, whether that's music, stamp collecting, do you know what I mean? Like anything that gives you joy and inspiration, that's what's going to come through in your work. So never be afraid to go to the things and the places that you love, and pour that into your work. Like, it doesn't have to be great art or, you know, highbrow stuff or all the classics. You know, you haven't had to have read, you know, don't have to go to the RSC and watch all of Shakespeare to be able to write. You can look at photographs and come up with a story, and it's going to be brilliant, you know. So that's what I hope.
Yeah, Caroline on the chat is just saying something very, very along those lines, you know, about having just come off a university course, uni writing course, and just kind of feeling drained of inspiration, but actually, you know, that these ideas and exercises have been so great, bringing back my sense of humanity, emotion, and instinct. So,
oh, bless you for that. Thank you. And I think also we need a sense of humour in it all too. Like, what are we doing? Like, why are we writing? It's madness, but it's also brilliant. And, yeah. You know, if you can find the things that take the pressure off, it can help so much. And I think when you've got deadlines to hit and it can feel daunting, or you're just starting out and it can feel daunting, it's really easy to go, I'm not going to do anything because it's better that way. But actually just do like 3 minutes and see how you feel. Like, start with really small chunks of the day. Like, I have to plan my days around the kids, but like, I'll make sure that maybe there's a block of an hour if I haven't got something big where I'll just write or just research. And don't be afraid to research either. Like, spend hours on archives and reading. Like, Lindsay Turnin, amazing director who I worked with on Under Milk Wood, and she was like, you know, you can read as a writer, right? You know, that's part of the thing. Like, you don't have to be writing all the time. You can go and read and watch and listen and live. And that's really important as well. Like, don't feel you have to sit there and just work your way through it. Like, just, even if you just write for 3 minutes a day, you're still a writer. Even if you don't write at all and you just read loads of books, you're still a writer. It's all still going on. And so just use that inspiration in whatever form it comes. You don't listen to anybody else.
I just wanted to say, Siân, that I was really happy about you saying about cutting and pasting and sticking things and stuff, because when I started writing this play that I'm really struggling trying to write now, and this is ages ago, because I started ages ago, was I started a scrapbook with all like pictures of people that they might look like, the characters, or I don't know, just sort of place, like photographs of places and things like that. And I put it away and I felt embarrassed about it, because I thought, well, that's not writing. That's
absolutely writing. It's absolutely writing. I have a mood board for each of my projects. Like, sticking things out, putting them up around me. I'm working at the moment on a thing, and I've got like a whole, like, post-it notes, pictures. Do you love... Does that help with your creativity as well, like sticking and gathering and researching?
Making collage. I love making collages and things and looking.
So that's you. That's part of the way you work. There's no, absolutely no way you should feel anything other than brilliant about that. It's just your way of pulling stuff in.
I think since I have got it back out since meeting Box of Tricks. I have got it back out actually and started the. I just wanted to say one thing. This is probably a different workshop, but what I find difficult is I don't have any problem at all with coming up with images and stuff, ideas and stuff. But how do you personally go from having a really powerful image, say, in your head? You know, it's the kind of going from that to a story that I find really difficult.
And maybe I should have talked more of that today. I think it's finding the story you want to tell, the truth you want to tell, even if you don't know what the big thing is. Maybe you've got just a phrase in your mind, like, I want to tell the story of someone who's betrayed, or I want to tell the story of Jack. And you know exactly who Jack is. And then just build it up ever so slowly, scene by scene. Just start writing. Like, you can write the end scene first. Like, if you've got something in your mind and you've got a strong character and a strong image, just start writing. That a really powerful thing to do is writing from their perspective as well, like maybe monologues, just to kind of get to know them. But I think for me, so for example, with, let's talk about like what Adam and I are doing. We had an idea, and I knew it was about a friendship of some girls, and I knew music was really important, and I knew I wanted to set it in a nightclub. So I wrote two scenes, I think, two or three scenes. And it was terrible, and I don't think any of it survived, but it was just about finding out who they were, who they're talking to. Like, you might just, I think in the act of writing, sometimes the characters tell you what's going to happen, and like other people invite themselves in and they're like, oh, hello, who are you? You're new, you know. So I think just don't worry too much about the end product, I'd say. Just baby steps. You've got the collage, you've got the world, you've got the character. Write the first scene or write the last scene. Write a scene or a monologue with the person in it that you know is in the story. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does totally make, yeah, I sort of know what you mean, yeah. Yeah, it's kind of when you start thinking, well, what's the whole story, and, you know, and who's that, and what the, you know, what's their relationship to that person, and what are they going to say? Yeah. It's like when you start thinking about the whole thing, and how's it going to end, and what's it all about, and what's the point of writing it? I find that, you know, it's like getting caught up in all of that stops you from, well, stops me from writing anything at all.
It does. I describe it like trying to catch fireflies. Like, you've got this amazing idea, like, look at the world, like, why can't you see into my brain? Like, I was talking to Adam about it, and I was like, come on, you know what's going to happen. And he was just like, dude, I don't know what you're on about. And you're like, you can see bits of it, and it can be really strong. But I think if you try and get it all straight away, it's just too much. And I think sometimes it's scarier just starting, because it's so messy at the start.
Mm-hmm.
It's to be messy, be inspired by the mess. Like, look how the collage builds up, and over like 10 pages, then it becomes a story in itself. Like, just embrace the utter chaos of a first scene and a first draft. And the brilliant thing someone told me recently is that even on a first draft, you can write things like, I don't know what happens here. And why didn't no one tell me that 10 years ago? So, you know, you can even have like tiny bits of dialogue, massive I don't know, but you know where it wants to come out in the wash. So just allow it to be like a collage, because that's obviously how you work and how your mind works, which is brilliant. And then over time, and with guidance from people like Adam and Hannah, the craft of it, then we can get you to the actual kind of, you know, the structure and the arc of things. But at the beginning, just get it all down. Don't worry about it. Embrace
that's the- really that's really, so just that's really encouraging to hear, because I find I get lost like in the stream of consciousness of it all. And even with those exercises, I really enjoyed all of them, and like the diary one in particular, I didn't think that actually there's an awful lot there just to unpack, isn't there? And I'm definitely going to go down that route. But I was really glad when you said that we're not going to share, because I do find I was enjoying what I was pulling together. But it would make no sense if I were to read it out loud. But I might revisit some of it, because I thought, well, I teased out a few things and a few little ideas, a few little nuggets where I was like, oh, that's cool. I quite like what, you know, where that might go. But, you know, in its present state, just forget it. It's a complete shambles. And I sometimes, that puts me off then when I, you know, in other pieces of work that I've kind of abandoned, I guess, because I've thought like, I just don't know where to go with this now, even though it felt like, okay, there was maybe some good in there. But the chaos was just became overwhelming, I suppose.
I totally get it. And I think, thank you for saying it helped. That's really lovely to hear.
I did, yeah.
I think when you go and see a play or watch a TV series, or, you know, it's so polished and so smart.
Mm.
And I think you can just be like, oh, how is that gonna end up there? But if I could tell you what the beginning of Endermilk would look like as I started, like, you wouldn't believe it. Like, absolute bomb site of a mess. The same with the musical I'm doing and previous plays, like, they all started with maybe a line or two lines, absolute unknowns, black holes, lots of pictures and some songs. And I often do that actually in my first drafts. I send, I don't know what happens in this scene, but I want it to feel like this.
Yeah.
I'll put a link in, like, poor Adam's had to. Yeah. But like, so then the biggest bit of advice is that if I can give anyone, is embrace the chaos. embrace the black holes. They're terrifying, but it'll come. And the worst thing to do, I think, is to let that noise get in the way. Listen to the quieter voices, listen to the one that you love, listen to the song that reminds you of someone that you want to put in the play. Do you know what I mean? Like, just keep listening to the quieter bits, because the blank pages and the noise of a final piece, or who am I going to send it to, or how is this going to work? Try and shut all that out and put a song on you love and just go for it. Like, I just, it's the hardest thing, I think, going on that journey and taking a bet on yourself. But, you know, you're going to find gold, and you just got to keep digging and just be really patient with yourself and kind. And don't, and like I said, don't feel like you have to sit there for hours and hours and torture yourself. Like, just write for 10 minutes, then you've done something for the day, and it's like, yes, you know, like, it's, you don't have to do it. And then there'll be other days when you can write for 5 hours. Like, there's, yeah. I found there's absolutely no rhyme or reason to how it works. And especially in what we're living with at the moment, you know, like, the noise of everything else can come in, and it's impossible to be creative. And some days you can't, but, you know, just do one of these exercises and you've got something to work on the next day.
Yeah.
Don't listen. Thank you. Embrace it.
Yeah.
Amazing. Has anybody else got any questions?
I was going to ask, sorry, me again, about actually sort of physically, in terms of sitting down to write. Sometimes I just wonder if maybe it's just the surroundings that are stale, and to move elsewhere and try, and if that unlocks something for someone else. And if you have a go-to place that you think, now this is always where, you know, where the magic happens for me. Or is it sort of a case of mixing it up, and whether the decisions are made around, okay, this is the type of thing I'm looking to write, so I'm going to do it over there or go somewhere else. I don't know. Does that make sense?
Yeah. For me personally, I don't know about other people, but I like to move with each project. So like when I was writing Underwood, I was in London a lot. I'm back in London now working on something. I mean, that's very lucky. You know, I'm very lucky, because, you know, that's kind of, that space is given to me. But even just like moving around your house, you know, like maybe one room is just not working for you. So that's not to say it's always not going to work for you, but maybe there's something about this project that you need to be in the garden, or if you haven't got a garden, go to the park, or, you know, or in your kitchen. I think, and especially because we've all been in so much, I think it's even harder to find that calm. Like, I find writing from home quite hard, because then I'm always like the washing, and like the kids have got stuff and the stuff and things and the shopping and Tesco's. Do you know what I mean? So like, but if you can just set up a little area just for that day, and then maybe move the next day. Because I think you pressure on yourself to sit down in one place and write the thing. Like, I move all around my house, drives my husband absolutely mad. It's like, where are you? I'm like, in the kitchen. So
yeah.
I think when you get into the, like, when the scenes start flowing and you're like kind of then properly putting things together, then it's easier just to sit. But when you're actually creatively finding stuff, I think you can be anywhere.
Yeah.
And I think there's places, there's places that, you know, offer sanctuary. There's writers' rooms, there's libraries. I always love a library. But also there's things, I don't know if you guys have heard about, I think it's called the London Writers Salon, where you can log on and write with other people for an hour. You don't share anything. You don't, I don't even have to talk to anyone, but you're literally all together writing. So it's like that kind of act of like, oh, okay, this is good. And then there are other bits they do where you can kind of have a coffee with other writers and check in with each other. So there are some amazing kind of prompts out there to kind of help you get in that headspace. But I know it's harder at the moment, I think.
Because over the last 2 years, I've found quite a lot of those sort of things online, you know, writing groups. I go to that London Writers Salon. I think they're really good.
Yeah.
The only thing is, it is quite expensive if you want to join properly. I mean,
oh, is it?
do lots of things with them. I've not been able to do that, but they do quite a bit of free stuff as well, like this you say, the writing hours, but also they do put these sort of motivational goal setting workshops which are free, which I find really useful, things like that. There's an amazing amount online now, because, you know, I know it's up for awful reasons, but if you can't go out, or you don't want to go out and stuff, or there is actually quite a lot of those sort of communities where you can just write with other people. You don't have to say anything or do anything, you just sit there and write with other people.
And I think that can be really helpful if you're in a tricky headspace in the environment you're in. It can be sometimes good just to be with other people and write, that can be really powerful. So yeah, that's a brilliant tip. Thank you.
Yeah, I'd add to that as well, just that sense of it's kind of touches on what you were saying earlier, Sean, about not just kind of, beating your head against a brick wall if it's not coming, if you don't find that, creative flow. And actually sometimes just getting out the house and just doing something different, that's when the solutions come. Do you know what I mean? When you're not thinking about it actively, that often those are the most kind of creative moments, and that you actually find inspiration through life. Yeah.
The amount of times I've texted myself when I didn't realized it was costing me money, but I've been in a queue or something, and I'd be like, that's it, that's the thing. And I'd be texting myself, and then I'd be like, oh, I've got a text. idiot. But just sometimes walking out and about or using notes on your phone. Some people I know actually voice record. It's not something that I do, but I know that quite a few writer friends kind of go on walks and suddenly they'll hit on something and they'll just record it on their thing so they can capture it. And no one else has to know what it means. It can be something it's the dude with the hat, that what that means, but no one else does. So there's so many ways of technology helping out at the moment as well. So yeah, get moving, I think, is a good thing if you can.
Amazing, thank you. Has anybody got any final questions, or shall we? I think in that case, yeah, we'll wrap up. Thank you so much, Sean. That's been absolutely amazing.
Oh, thank you. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for having me.
To be honest with you, at the moment, finding inspiration, like you're saying, living through a pandemic is hard. But just finding those ways in and those exercises, I found really, really useful and really insightful. And I know that, we've used a lot of that kind of stuff in terms of developing How Soon Is Now, so you had to kind of get inside your brain for an hour as well and see the other side of it.
It's messy but honestly, if I can help, if there's links or anything that you're not sure of, or something that was too quick or you didn't catch, just give Adam a shout, and I'm here if you need me.
Yeah, we can just send those resources out if anybody does want to. So yeah, just follow up with an email and we can send those out to you.
Go forth and be brilliant, writers.